be a little short, but there's so many other lines on here.
Okay, are you ready for a good laugh? Here we go.
I have this sign in my room that says salt water cures all, and I really think that's true. I'm a little bit of a high-strung person, so anytime I get out in the water, I feel like that all goes away.
A little rusty.
Yeah.
Sorry. No worries.
And it's just you in nature. My name is Missy Weiss, and I am the Director of Citizen Science and Education with the Ocean Research and Conservation Association, or ORCA. The Indian River Lagoon is an estuary, so that means that its water is a combination of salt water from the oceans and fresh water from rivers, lakes, and streams. And so that is one of the attributes about the Indian River Lagoon that's so important, because it allows it to be incredibly biodiverse. In fact, it has over 4,400 different types of plants and animals, and is considered the most biologically diverse estuary in the nation.
Right there, dolphin.
You can see the blowhole. That's so cool. Never gets old.
Mm-mm.
Never.
Not yet. Yay! Oh, a cock! Not even a hermit crab.
As an applied science research organization, we try to accumulate as much data as we possibly can to look at the problems of the lagoon holistically. What's important about the collection of that data is that it is scientifically sound, that it's reliable, it's unbiased, and it's usable to anyone. Baby shark, it's where my head is.
Tell me you're a mom without telling me you're a mom.
Exactly. There are a lot of different problems that are affecting the lagoon, and those problems are complicated and immense. ORCA's whole tagline is mapping pollution, finding solutions. We're trying to uncover those pollutants so that we can hopefully track the source of those pollutants. But if we don't stop it at its source, it's just going to keep coming back. So it's an uphill battle.
That grass right there straight ahead, where it goes sloping grassy lawn directly to a waterway.
Yeah.
If you were to install just a simple strip of native vegetation, we recommend about 10 feet wide, then those plants act as a physical and chemical barrier to any of the pollutants that are coming from that grass.
We collect sediments as part of all of our research, whether it's for living shoreline work, pollution mapping, ecotoxicity work. So when you find locations that have greater percentages of this muck or silt, you generally have greater concentrations of pollution. This muck is in some cases over 8 feet deep in the Indian River Lagoon because it's full of hydrogen sulfide. It's not exactly the best habitat for animal life, but also plant life.
My name is Ricardo Acra. Everybody calls me Ricky.
There we go, good dog.
Was raised in the Dominican Republic, came to the States for college, got my doctorate in pharmacy, and did that for 30 years. Kind of got burned out, you know? I just retired about a year and a half ago. That was a shock for me too when I retired. Like, it's not all what you think it is, you know? I did feel a little empty, kind of like something was missing, you know?
All right, so we're gonna do 12.
I saw this article about ORCA, and I said, oh, that's for me, you know? I could be part of the community, learning, getting engaged, and the laboratory part comes kind of natural to me, the microscope, my petting and diluting, that kind of stuff, because that's what I did for like 10 years as a med tech. I think we're making a change, an impact, but it takes a lot to slow down this progress of degradation of the Indian River. I just want to be able to help. I know I'm a small person in this, but the more people we get involved, the bigger difference we can make.
What we're doing today is we are taking fish that were caught in the Indian River Lagoon, donated by volunteers. And we have our citizen scientists who are trained helping us process those fish. They are taking out all the important tissues and organs, which will then later be analyzed for a whole host of different pollutants. We test for three different heavy metals in our fish tissue. With regards to mercury, we're finding that when we average all of our fish together, that those average mercury concentrations are exceeding the Florida Department of Health's advisory level for women of childbearing age and children. And in some cases, we're finding that on average, they're exceeding the joint advisory level from the EPA, FDOH, and DEP for the general population.
Next step up.
And so we're concerned about that because obviously we want to make our community aware of what they're consuming, if they're consuming it from the fish that they're catching and eating from our Indian River Lagoon. We cannot do anything that we do without the help of our citizen scientists.
Labor, yeah.
So this is and labor volunteers here. Like Ricky.
I used to think like, oh, it's just me alone, so this is not gonna make no change, you know. But then I realized, yeah, me alone, and just other people thinking that way too, and little by little, it'll be more and more and more. So we'll make a change. That's what I believe. This is not gonna be overnight. You have to have a love for this. And it's in me since my childhood.
I think if we wait for the next generation, it's too late. And that's one of the reasons why, again, I really like citizen science, is because you're getting people of all ages, not just children or students or younger adults. You're getting people that are senior citizens who are also participating. I'm a fairly optimistic person. Maybe it's just this innate optimism that I think we can do it. I want to see an Indian River Lagoon teeming with life, and you can see the bottom and the seagrass is wrapping around your ankles as you hear from the stories from people who have lived here their whole lives of what the lagoon used to look like. I want that to be a reality for my students. I want the stories of the past to be the stories of the present and future.